Have you noticed what a large number of horror movies seem to have been made over the last few years? Obviously, there must be a market for them, or people wouldn't go on making them. But then perhaps we tend to forget that there's always been a morbid streak in humankind that takes delight in the macabre and the bloodthirsty. I mean to say, Shakespeare wasn't one to spare us violent deaths in his plays, and the later Jacobeans piled on the horror even more. Then in the 19th century, Edgar Allan Poe became one of the world's most popular authors, while Mary Shelley's Frankenstein hasn't done badly since, has he? To say nothing of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, or even The Hound of the Baskervilles. And if you wonder what this has to do with music, I have this on offer for you this evening. Part of the literally fantastic symphony of Berlioz, a huge landmark in the development of romantic music, and utterly unlike anything that had ever been written before. At the time it was written, Schubert had been dead a mere 18 months, Schumann was only just beginning to compose, Mendelssohn was 19, and Wagner only 17. The fantastic symphony not only uses the orchestra in a quite unprecedented way, but tackles the whole concept of a symphony from a new angle, and a very personal one at that. Far from regarding the symphony as an abstract musical form, Berlioz used it as a means of self-projection, seeing himself as the hero figure, as Strauss was to do generations later in Ein Heldenleben. There are two main sources of inspiration for the work. De Quincey's Confessions of an Opium Eater, which Berlioz read avidly in a somewhat unreliable translation by Alfred de Musset, and this is far more important, the composer's own love life. As you probably know, he became wildly infatuated with an Irish actress called Harriet Smithson, whom he had seen playing in what was probably a rather tatty repertory company doing a Shakespeare season in Paris. Against all the odds, penniless student, loving actress from afar and all that, he actually married her. And a fair old disaster that was, though it's irrelevant to the tale today. However, no emotion in Berlioz's life could ever be simple or straightforward, and his feelings for his Irish lady love waxed and waned in a characteristically inconsistent manner. In February 1830, while he was actually working on the symphony, he wrote to a friend about his beloved. She is still in London, and yet I seem to feel her near me. All my former feelings for her are aroused and combine to tear me to pieces. I hear my heart beat, and its pulsations shake me as though they were the strokes of the pistons of a steam engine. Not the most romantic of metaphors, but at least it was up to date, since Stevenson's rocket had first startled the world the previous year. One finds it hard to take such expressions of passion seriously, since at the time he had never even spoken to her. A few months later, and still before he'd had any contact with her, disillusionment with his goddess set in. Rumour had it that her morals were less than perfect, and in the final movement of the symphony, written to glorify his love for her, he turned her into a witch. The symphony has an elaborate program written by Berlioz himself. This is how he describes its five movements. A young musician of extraordinary sensibility and abundant imagination. I wonder who that can be. In the depths of despair, because of hopeless love, has poisoned himself with opium. The drug is too feeble to kill him, but plunges him into a heavy sleep accompanied by weird visions. His sensations, emotions, and memories, as they pass through his affected mind, are transformed into musical images and ideas. The beloved one herself becomes to him a melody, a recurrent theme, which haunts him continually. The first movement, reveries and passions. First he remembers that weariness of the soul, that indefinable longing, that somber melancholia, and those objectless joys which he experienced before meeting his beloved. Then the volcanic love with which he at once inspired him, his delirious suffering, his return to tenderness, his religious consolation. The second movement, a ball. At a ball, in the midst of a noisy, brilliant fete, he finds his beloved again. The third movement, in the country. On a summer evening in the country, he hears two herders calling each other with their shepherd melodies. The pastoral duet in such surroundings, the gentle rustle of the trees softly swayed by the wind, some reasons for hope which had come to his knowledge recently, all unite to fill his heart with a rare tranquillity and lend brighter colours to his fancies. But his beloved appears anew. Spasms contract his heart, and he is filled with dark premonition. What if she proved faithless? Only one of the shepherds resumes his rustic tune. The sun sets. Far away there is rumbling thunder, solitude, silence. The fourth movement, march to the scaffold. He dreams he has killed his loved one, that he is condemned to death and led to his execution. A march, now gloomy and ferocious, now solemn and brilliant, accompanies the procession. Noisy outbursts are followed without pause by the heavy sound of measured footsteps. Finally, like a last thought of love, the idée fixe appears for a moment, to be cut off by the fall of the axe. Lastly, the fifth movement, dream of a witch's Sabbath. He sees himself at a witch's Sabbath, surrounded by a fearful crowd of spectres, sorcerers, and monsters of every kind, united for his burial. Unearthly sounds, groans, shrieks of laughter, distant cries, to which others seem to respond. The melody of his beloved is heard, but it has lost its character of nobility and reserve. Instead, it is now an ignoble dance tune, trivial and grotesque. It is she who comes to the Sabbath. A shout of joy greets her arrival. She joins the diabolical orgy. The funeral knell, burlesque, of the Dies Irae, dance of the witches, the dance and the Dies Irae combined. Now, in one scant half hour, I can hardly do justice to a work which takes all of 50 minutes to play. Perhaps the best thing to do in the time available is to follow the course of the idée fixe, the fixed idea, the theme that Berlioz associated with his beloved. As themes go, it isn't all that amazing, relying a little too much on sequences.
Thank you.
But if the tune itself is not amazing, Berlioz's treatment of it is. For instead of underpinning it with some nice respectable or even warmly romantic harmony, he gives it a throbbing accompaniment that has the pulsations of the steam engine of which he wrote. The effect is extraordinary. No living soul could have taught Berlioz to orchestrate like that, nor to harmonize the theme itself in so unorthodox a way. It's sheer genius, a token of the extraordinary confidence of a composer still in his 20s. Now, in his program notes, Berlioz used such phrases as return to tenderness and delirious sufferings. Can we trace where such moments actually occur, or are they just romantic hyperbole? Well, let me draw your attention to one section about three-quarters of the way through the movement. In the cellos, we have constant reminders of the idée fixe. Meanwhile, the oboe introduces a completely new and very expressive melody. This, surely, is the return to tenderness. But in a matter of moments, the music changes, so that in the wind instruments we find distorted phrases full of wailing and lamenting, truly the delirious suffering of which he wrote. The moods change so fast it's hard to keep up with them. This is less true of the other movements. For instance, the scene at the ball is basically a waltz. Remember, this was written 10 years before Tchaikovsky was born. An elegant introduction, featuring two harps for the first time in a symphonic score, leads to this enchanting waltz. Suddenly, the beloved's theme appears, cold and aloof, serenely gliding through the throng of dancers. Berlioz's reaction is usually underplayed in performance. Listen to the cellos and basses and the agitation they are clearly conveying as his heart pounds with excitement. The music exists at two quite different emotional levels. In due course, the waltz theme returns, and the theme of the beloved disappears. Only near the end of the movement do we catch a final glimpse of it. Perhaps the young hero sees his love climbing into her carriage, for there's a real feeling of loneliness here, like one of those always so effective film shots of a face looking from an upper window. At any rate, she goes, and he is instantly swept away in a swirling cavalcade of dancers. The slow movement begins with a very evocative duet between oboe and cor anglais, supposedly two shepherds answering each other across the valley. The scoring is for the most part remarkably economical, a line and wash drawing rather than an oil painting. But that changes when once again the hero sees his beloved strolling through the countryside. What a contrast there is between her theme. And the almost savage intensity of his reaction. Is he already racked by jealousy? Here the orchestra is being used in a virtually operatic way, and it's worth remembering that Berlioz originally thought of it as a stage work. Not surprisingly, thoughts of the beloved aren't very much to the fore in the fourth movement, the March to the Scaffold, since Berlioz pinched it from an earlier work, Les Francs Juges, written in what might be called the pre-Harriet era. But at the final critical moment, when he sees himself standing by the guillotine facing death, a memory of her steals into his mind, only to be literally severed by the crash of the falling blade and the graphic bounce of the severed head down the steps. You see what I meant about horror movies. So we come to the extraordinary last movement, in which Harriet becomes a witch, leading her coven in a celebration of the Black Mass. Her first appearance, on horseback, the timpani seem to indicate, is a grotesque travesty of the idée fixe theme. After that tremendous baying welcome, an orchestral sound the like of which had never been conceived by any previous composer, Harriet the Witch circles the graveyard in which the coven is gathered, while gobbling bassoons depict the approving cackle of the assembled crones. From now on, the movement is dominated by the dies irae theme, treated in a number of positively sensational ways, which I haven't time to illustrate now. It's worth saying, though, that it was no part of Berlioz's original plan. There exists, in his own hand, a verbal sketch of the symphony's plot, if I may use such a word, which describes the finale as a vision of a night of revelry. No mention of witches or the day of wrath. Only when his love turns sour was the intended gaiety changed to a scene of horror. As it is, the end is calculated to leave the listener exhausted, reeling beneath the impact of the relatively huge resources which Berlioz deploys with such inventive skill. The music may at times seem naive, even second-rate, but the originality of the conception and the fearless exploitation of the orchestra make the work a quite outstanding landmark in musical history. Beethoven had been dead a mere 3 years when this work was first performed. He may not have turned in his grave, but his ghost would surely have acknowledged the genius of a fellow rebel against convention.
Final bars of Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique, played by the Paris Orchestra, conducted by Daniel Barenboim.